Talks.
Hey everyone, thank you for joining us today for the webinar. My name is Nitesh. I'm the Principal Product Manager at Amazon Web Services. And I'm really excited to share with you the Amazon Aurora I optimized cluster configuration. Today we'll be covering how you can improve the price performance of your IO intensive workloads and benefit from predictable pricing. So today's agenda, we'll go into an overview of Aurora's billing model and what are the different components of your Aurora bill. Next, we will go into some of the common challenges that customers and enterprises run into with Aurora's billing model, specifically around IO charges, which stands for input and output operations. Next, we'll go into why we launched Aurora IO Optimized and some of the reasons that we did so and how customers can use this cluster configuration. And then I'll give you a short overview of how to get started on the Aurora IO Optimized model using the RDS console or even the CLI. All right, so today Aurora customers only pay for what they use. So there are three components of your Aurora bill that every customer pays for. First, it's the compute, that includes instances, which could be an R5, R6i, or it also includes our Aurora serverless V2 auto-scaling compute model that scales for unpredictable workloads based on how much compute is needed for that application. Next, customers pay for storage, and this is pay-as-you-go only. There is nothing to provision. So if you're using 100 GB of storage today and you go to 80 GB tomorrow, you only pay for the 80 GB because Aurora storage auto-scales. And finally, input-output operations, or IO, which includes read and write operations, which is reading and writing data from the Aurora's distributed storage system. Sometimes it could also include operational activities such as auto-vacuuming on the PostgreSQL, which could also consume IOs. Next, most customers also pay for data transfer of moving data, and then also backups, which could include snapshots, which could be for disaster recovery or audit purposes. And finally, Aurora offers a lot of features that our customers have come to know and love. The most common ones are Aurora Global Database, which is meant for disaster recovery, fast database cloning, Aurora Backtrack, export to S3, and all these are based on if you're using this feature or if you have a need for this feature and you only enable it and you only pay for what you use for these features. Now, double-clicking into IO or input-output operations, like I mentioned, IOs are usually consumed by operational activity, read operations, or write operations. So your write operations for Aurora can depend on a few factors. Most often it's related to your workload pattern. For example, we had a customer that was moving data from an on-premise database into Aurora. And in the interim, they also had an Aurora database that was a staging platform. So in that requirement, they were writing twice. First, writing into the Aurora staging database, then writing into their final Aurora destination. So as you can imagine, this application pattern is very write intensive. So their write IO charges were quite a bit higher than what we would consider average or normal for the average customer. So a lot of customers also consume read IOs based on their application patterns, just like how I covered for write operations. For example, Aurora has a cache and your frequently accessed data is stored in the cache. But some customers might be reading data from Aurora's shared storage volume, which what we consider could be cold data. So it's data that they don't really access frequently, but they might need it for their application. And again, in this situation, your read operations would be higher than what we would consider average. And similarly, the configuration of your cluster, for example, your database instance size dictates how big your cache is. So a smaller database size would lead to a smaller cache, which means you're going to the shared distributed volume more often than what we would consider, again, average. So like I mentioned, both write operations and read operations and operational activity contribute to your IO charges. And these charges can vary for your customers, for our customers, based on different spend patterns. So here we have a customer that used Aurora for about 30 weeks. The orange line is their compute usage or instances. The purple line is their I/O usage or read and write operations. And then the pink line is the pink section is their storage. So as you can see, their storage charges were pretty much the same. Instance charges fluctuated quite a bit, but because of their I/O charges, again, the purple line, their bill fluctuated quite a bit. It went all the way from, let's say, 12,000 to 18,000. So you can see here, this is what's causing them to get a what we consider, or what they said, was an unpredictable bill because their I/O charges are making their Aurora charges fluctuate quite a bit. So because of this, to answer these concerns and to give customers a predictable bill with a better price performance option, we launched Amazon Aurora I/O Optimize, which is a new cluster configuration. And in this configuration, you do not pay for any read and write operations. You only pay for your compute and storage, and compute could include serverless V2, your instances, and the storage is what we covered is pay-as-you-go only. Customers that are using global database will still continue paying for the replicated IOs for global database. That's one of the caveats that I should mention because that's not a read and write operation. Next, you do get price predictability because, again, like I mentioned, read and write operations are quite variable. They depend on your application access pattern and your data pattern. And so that's why without any IO charges, it's much more easier to estimate your database spend upfront, whether you're an existing customer bringing on new workloads or migrating to Aurora for the first time. And then for customers who usually have a high IO heavy pattern, that's where the savings materialize. And what we have seen in our analysis is if IO is more than 25% of your total Aurora spend, then you can get up to 40% cost savings. And the next point is improved performance. So we have made some software optimizations that improve the throughput of your application and also reduce the latency for IO intensive applications. And Aurora cluster configuration, the IO Optimize is available for both Aurora Postgres and Aurora MySQL for Aurora Serverless V2 and provisioned on-demand and RI instances. So here's again an overview of what this model looks like and the price flexibility that customers get by the launch of Aurora IO Optimized. So the existing model, which customers already know and are familiar with, is the Aurora, which we now call Aurora Standard. And on the right side, we have Aurora IO Optimized. So on the current model that most customers might be using, customers pay for your compute, they pay for storage, and then you pay for IO, which is pay per request, and then the other cost components, such as data transfer, backup, and all the features, which I already went into. And Aurora IO Optimized, customers pay for compute, but the charges will be 30% higher. That's sort of the new price point for the compute options on Aurora IO Optimized. On storage, there'll be a 125% uplift on your storage charges, but again, pay for use, similar to Aurora Standard. And there are no more charges for read and write IOs. It is worth mentioning that customers on reserved instances do not, at this point, have to buy new RIs. The Aurora IO Optimized configuration will automatically account for the price difference when you move from Aurora Standard to Aurora IO Optimized. And what I mean by that is Aurora Standard reserved instance will be burned down much faster on Aurora IO Optimized because of the 30% higher uplift on the model. And there is a pricing example on our pricing page to go into more details on how this works. But that's one of the things I do want to call out. And again, the asterisk here is that customers will continue to pay for the replicated writes or the replicated IOs. And customers can select a different cost for their primary, at least at this point, for their primary cluster and the secondary cluster when using an Aurora global database. So here's what a customer's bill looks like after moving to Aurora IO Optimized. So before, the bill, the example that I shared a few slides ago was the customer's spend over 30 weeks on Aurora Standard. And again, the spikiness is primarily driven by the purple line, which is IO. And you can see that after they moved to Aurora IO optimized, their overall bill went down quite a bit. So the highest point that they had in the previous slide on the left slide is roughly $17,000. And now their bill doesn't exceed anywhere from $12,000 up to $12,000. But the trade-off is here, you can see their orange lines, which is instance, is now higher than their Aurora standard spend. This is again because of the 30% premium. And then their pink section, which is the storage part, is also a bit higher because of the 125% uplift on the storage charges. But their overall bill is much more steady. It doesn't spike as much, and the overall bill has also gone down quite a bit. So that's some of the benefits of moving to Aurora IO optimized. And here's what that looks like in our console. So right before the instance configuration, where you select whether you want to go on to Aurora Serverless V2 or select an instance, you select the cluster storage configuration. And in that, you select either Aurora Standard, which I mentioned is the current pay-as-you-go cost-effective for most applications, or Aurora IO optimized, and then you get all the benefits and the goodies that I mentioned earlier. It is worth mentioning that if you are trying to create a new cluster and you see that Aurora IO optimized is grayed out or not available, it's likely that you're either not in the right on the right instance. For example, some of the older instances, such as R4 and T2, which are quite a bit old, are not supported on this new configuration. And we only support specific versions of MySQL and PostgreSQL. So if you're not on those versions, or if you're on an older instance, then Aurora IO optimized might not be an option for you to select. But if you rectify that, you should be able to move quite quickly. And the same thing applies for if you're trying to modify an existing cluster or apply a change. There are also CLI commands. So if you look at the CLI or read our technical documentation, there's an option called storage type, or a parameter called storage type, when you create a new cluster or modify a new cluster. And there you can set that to IOPT, and it's one, there's a number, and then that gets you to the IO optimized model. So again, here's a few points and takeaways to remember with the IO optimized. So first, it's a cluster configuration and not an instance. So some customers might have up to, let's say, 15 instances, which Aurora allows in a specific cluster. You can't mix and match the configuration on every instance. If you apply it to one cluster, then it applies to all the instances in that cluster. Customers can move between IO optimized and standard once in a month, and you can switch back. So you can move from standard to IO optimized once a month, but you can switch back at any time. Again, this gives you a lot of flexibility for, let's say, if you have a peak time coming up where you know your IO charges are going to spike, you can prepare for that. Next, we have some of the versions that we support today. So it's available from 13.x onwards. So 13.x includes 13.x onwards, 14.x, and 15.x. And on Aurora MySQL, that's 3.0.3.1 onwards. And it's compatible with some of these instances that are launched here. So T3, R5, R6i, T4Gs, all the Graviton instances, including the recently launched R7G, and then also Aurora Serverless V2. And again, like I mentioned earlier, a global database cluster can have a different configuration at a cluster level, and you can combine, mix and match if you want to do that for the primary and secondary cluster in one in the primary and secondary region. And with that, I'll wrap it up, and thank you for everyone's time, and feel free to contact me on the email here.